Well, it's, first, let me say it's a pleasure to come down here. I guess the last time I visited Tampa and gave a talk to your group, it's been more than 10 years ago, I know that. And really what I want to talk about is a revision to the Paleo-Indian point typology in Florida. And at the end of this, I would like to make the argument that it's far more diverse than we have recognized in the past. But I think first, we need to understand the origins of Paleo-Indian tool typology, both on a national as well as a local to Florida level. So in 1875, Jeffries Wyman in the St. John's River Valley, among the artifacts he recovered was this Clovis point. And that's a lithograph from his 1875 publication. I guess he did the field work 1874. And he claimed that this was an early man artifact. And he was one among a number of people that found out the mainstream academic type peer review did not agree with that. And Wyman had sort of aligned himself with this guy, Charles Abbott, who was working a site in the Trenton Gravels in New Jersey, and he had a very simple hypothesis. If you had a very refined looking stone tool, that must be younger. If you had a very crude looking stone tool, well, that must belong to the troglodytes and it must be very old. And actually, he was wrong. Charles Abbott was finding things like this, and today we would recognize that as a biface preform. They're making a point, they hadn't completed it yet, or they may have broken it or decided that that preform wasn't going to make it and they just tossed it out. But that started a great deal of scrutiny on all old sites in the Americas, no matter what. So if we go back to Jeffrey Wyman's in the St. John's River, although he did get one thing right, that Clovis point was a representative of a Pleistocene artifact. But he didn't know that. He just said all of these crude-looking tools were the same age. So he was, or rude tools, I should say. So the main adversaries to anybody that would claim to have a site that would be people and Pleistocene critters associated with each other at the same time were William Henry Holmes, who insisted that they had to have good context before you could prove it, and Alshard Leka, who had his mind made up that there were no Pleistocene people in the Americas, so no matter what anybody found, it wasn't going to be so. Which is interesting because in 1895, Samuel Williston, with a group of professional paleontologists that had been digging dinosaur sites and other fossil sites all over the Americas, they had a very good technique for digging the bones up, found a Folsom Point with Bison antiquus remains in Kansas. But it not only wasn't accepted, it was just totally ignored as a possibility of a site that might be Paleo-Indian in age. It was just totally passed by. By the turn of the 20th century, there was no typology of Paleo-Indian tool types because an important question remained unanswered. Did humans occupy the New World during the Pleistocene? Well, one of the first people shortly after the turn of the century to come into the fray was a guy named Elijah Sellards, who was a first state geologist, and he was down doing a fossil dig in Vero and claimed to have found artifacts and human remains in association with Pleistocene fauna. And there is the skull cap of the famous or infamous Vero man, which Alshard Leka just said no to. This is an idealized rendition put out by the Florida Geological Survey of sort of troglodytes hunting cave bears back in the Pleistocene. And then from 1915 to 1918, the Vero Man site investigations, E.H. Sellard, state geologist, believed he had an association, to which Al Serdlicka just said no, hell no. And so the controversy was on. This is sort of an aside. They're going to be opening up the Vero site beginning January 15th. For the first time since E.H. Sellard's looked at it, I guess they ended that dig in 1918, and it should be definitive as to what the age is and the association of human remains, artifacts, in Pleistocene fauna. But that's to be announced. It's going to be about a four-month dig over there. But the bearing it had on Florida, this argument that E.H. Sellard's was into with Al Serdlicka, who was a Smithsonian Institute physical anthropologist, actually did have some kind of bearing, because when Sellard's left Florida and he went to Texas, Herman Gunner came in as a state geologist, the second state geologist in Florida, and they were recovering the remains of mastodons, a mastodon skeleton at Wakulla Springs in Florida. That's when Ed Ball was building the big hotel that you can go now and stay and that type of thing. And it was interesting, but nobody said anything about artifacts being found at that site. So a little bit of time passed. We're outside Florida now, and it took the discoveries at Folsom and Blackwater Draw number one to absolutely demonstrate that people lived during the Pleistocene in with Pleistocene animals, and they actually hunted some. And so by 1935, pretty much, people started recognizing, well, there were Pleistocene people in Florida after all. And this is the type of discoveries they were making out in the desert southwest, a Folsom Point associated with bison Antiguus ribs, and so forth. In 1930, when the Wakulla dig was going on, there was absolutely no mention of artifacts. But one of the divers that was diving and recovering the remains at Wakulla Springs, after it was accepted that there were Paleo-Indian sites in the Americas, wrote a letter, and he said, well, we found artifacts there. One of the important things, in 1930, Clovis was recognized over Folsom. In September 1941, there was a symposium in Santa Fe, New Mexico, where Folsom was formalized and restricted to the Folsom Point we know today. But type names had been out there, like Yuma, which was sort of a catch-all for different types. So in this letter that Clarence Simpson wrote, and we don't know exactly what year it is, but it's 1940, 1941, somewhere in there, and he was talking about Yuma points from Florida. Well, what he really meant was Clovis or Folsom-like points. All he knew is that they were lancelet points, and they were found with ivory pieces and that type of thing. But he does formally say that they found Yuma-like points not only in the Itchituttany River, but at the Wakulla Springs mastodon. So Clarence Simpson, way early on, had probably found more information about associations of these early animals and artifacts than anybody before him. And these are the photos he sent in that original letter. They're grainy, they're not the best. And these are from the Itchituttany site, three ivory shafts and two, well, I'd call them wasted Swanee points now. And this is a little bit better photo of them from the archives of the Florida Geological Survey. And World War II comes and goes, and after World War II, in the initial volume of the Florida Anthropologist in 1948, Clarence Simpson publishes the article, Folsom-like Points from Florida, and gets a lot of interest. The first person that contacts him and does something is Stan Olson. But quite frankly, in a letter back to Alfred Romer at Harvard University, got his degree, he sort of thought Simpson was a country bumpkin. And he didn't put too much stock in what he'd found in the Itchituttany River, and he sort of blew it off. But I'd never met Clarence Simpson in my life. He died in 1952, but I think he was a little bit smarter than that. But this, at least, is a strat map that Olson came up with, and I just digitized it from a sketch drawing he did of the Itchituttany. And what I find so odd about it is that he recognized here was a channel cut, and there was a shell marl and calcitic channel fill sequence over here, and that's where these mastodon bones were eroding from, and I don't know why he didn't like that site other than it was in a river channel. But anyway, that's history and we can't go back. So by 1950, Clarence Simpson was contacted by John Goggin. And Simpson said, well, you should go to the mouth of the Santa Fe River, and he led him to the Suwannee County side of the river. And from the investigations that Goggin did there, even though I think maybe one of these point bases may be from that site, they didn't find stratigraphic order over there, but they found some lancelet points, and there were other sites that Goggin had seen lancelet points, and he came up with a type name of Suwannee. So he was the first person to name a type that was a Paleo-Indian lancelet point in the state of Florida. This article was put in American Antiquity. Another very important person, in my opinion, is William E. Edwards, who got pulled into Florida by Irving Rouse. Irving Rouse was working South Indian fields down in Brevard County. And in Rouse's work, he stumbled across something that looked like some Paleo-Indian material at what became known as the Lake Helen Blazes site. So Edwards ended up doing his dissertation on that site, but he also, importantly, worked with Clarence Simpson on a number of North Florida sites, some underwater, some on land. Unfortunately, Clarence Simpson died in 1952, and for whatever reason, Edwards and the Geological Survey sort of had a falling out, and they hired Stan Olson at the Geological Survey. The significance of that we'll talk about later. Probably the next important happening was 1958, Wilford T. Neal. Wilford T. Neal was hired as a zoologist, at the museum in Gainesville, and he worked there for a while, but he had a problem. He had a wicked sense of humor, and he didn't suffer fools. And if he thought you were a fool, he would pull horrible jokes on you. And so he left there with a little bit of a tainted reputation, shall we say, and he took over management of Ross Allen's Reptile Institute. And somebody brought to his attention that in Silver Springs Attraction, there was a sand borrow pit in which they had found lancelet points. So he went out and did an excavation of what is known as the Paradise Park site. And this is the best I can do. These are sort of a silhouette drawing of two Clovis points that came from this area of the site. And this is a low point. These are sand cliffs from the borrow pit, and this is the uplands. And by going back, Tom Hemmings went in 1974, Mike Fought and Dave Fulman went there in 2003, and we went back in 2009 and managed to pretty much reestablish where Neal's original pits were. But that single archaeological dig put Florida on the map as having Paleo-Indian sites. Prior to that time, people were not so sure. They weren't as sure of the association. But Neil found Clovis points at the bottommost level. When Neil published his article in the Florida Anthropologist in 1958, he was pretty much thinking he had Clovis-like points, but he deferred to John Goggin because John Goggin had named Swanee points, so he called them Swanee points that looked like Clovis's. In 1964, Neil pretty much retracted that, saying that at the Paradise Park site, they did have Clovis points. So probably the next big development in typology was Ripley Bullen. In 1968, he came out with his first point book, but this is a letter to the state archaeologist at the time, Ross Morrell, on February 9, 1967, where Bullen sent a draft of his point type book to Ross for review, and a year after that, they published the first point typology of all points in Florida, not just Paleo-Indian. And then it was revised in 1975. And that was the first flesh and good shot at trying to put all these points in some kind of chronological order. And I will say this, because way back when I was a student of Chuck Fairbanks, and Chuck Fairbanks in his class would grouse. You know, I had a grad student that was going to do a point typology for Florida. But the fellow went over and saw Bullen, and Bullen got real nervous, and he hurriedly put this point typology together that he had been meaning to do, and he got it published. So his student never got a shot at it. But, well, I think it, in a way, it's probably good that they got Bullen moving and that typology came out. It's not perfect, but more important than the book is the typecase collection that Bullen assembled at the museum in Gainesville, and it still exists there today. So if you look at Bullen's type for Paleo-Indian, and we're just going to consider three of them here, Clovis, and somehow he had Clovis into five subtypes, and then Simpson, and somehow he had Simpson into three subtypes, and then he had Swanee, and he only showed one image of a Swanee, and that was it. What's ironic about that, if you look at Bullen's typecase, and this is just some of the pieces, you know what he meant, because if you look at that point up there, he wrote Clovis on it, or Simpson, or Swanee. He wrote the type name that he meant on it. He gives us a baseline that I think is vitally important to try to improve what we know about these points. And, you know, he was pretty much looking at outlines, but the thing that flabbergasts me the most is he has very few Clovis in his typecase collection. He's got more than one, but he's got very few. He's got very few Simpson in his typecase collection. But he has a ton of things that he calls Swanee in his typecase collection, and they are highly varied. They're not just that. So if you look at his typecase book, his book, you would never know that. You have to go back to the typecase to understand that. This is an early effort I did. I took Bullen at his finest, and I took and erased the face of the points and just made outlines out of them. And these are the ones he thought were Clovis, and these are the Simpsons, and these are the Swanees. And you look at these Swanees, and there is a variety in there. There are some that are excavate, that are wasted or recurvate. And what is so much different about some of these here than, say, the Simpsons up on the top row? There isn't that much difference. And then you've got these parallel triangular-sided ones, and maybe ones that are heavily reworked, ones with expanded ears, and some that are recurvate and excavate flat base. And then the next person to do a little bit of revision on the typology is Grail Farr, and here he is wading through a pond in Cape Canaveral, getting ready to do some coring. But anyway, he published in a coherent way that the Santa Fe and the Tallahassee lancelet points that Bullen said were Paleo-Indian are in fact not. They're more like woodland, late archaic, and woodland forms that just happen to be lancelet. With that said, which really odd about it, if you look at Bullen's typecase collection, there are a few in each one of those that probably are Paleo-Indian, but most of them came from places that don't suggest Paleo-Indian, out of mound sites, and they're not patinated, and they're not really basally ground. So I think a lot of people are scrapping, well, they're still using Santa Fe and Tallahassee, but they use them in the context of something much later that is not Paleo-Indian. Which brings us to the this Paleo-Indian point typology that I'm doing here. Important attributes include the mental template for basal hafting morphology, the means of manufacture, and the post-production and maintenance resharpening of the point. In other words, considering all those things. And what I mean by a mental template, I think that people that were dependent on hunting a certain type of animal had a certain mental template of what it was like to make a Suwannee point. It's not like a machined part, but they're trying to make the basal half of the point the same way every time. And even though you may have a Suwannee point maker in Tampa versus one up on the Santa Fe River, or one over in the Chipola River, they're basically making them the same way. They may have slight differences, but the basal part of it, they have a certain idea in mind for the way they want to haft it to a certain size spear shaft, or if it's not a projectile point, say it's a knife, maybe a certain way they want to haft that thing to a certain kind of, who's to say, maybe bone shaft for a handle, something like that. And I think that's an important thing to think about. So what I did, this is a Suwannee point. It's not what I would call a Simpson point. Many collectors would probably call that a Simpson point because it's sort of wasted. But what I did is I would take a point like this and black silhouette it and then pull it into another program and just do a polygon outline of the point. Why am I doing that? For wasted Suwannee points, I found, and when I did my sort of them, 121, not all of them were whole. Some in the base area would have an ear knocked off. So what I was doing is stacking these things. So if you had a Suwannee point that big and a Suwannee point that big, it didn't matter because what I was doing is proportionately expanding the point so I could match the bases. And it's sort of, I call it a poor man's morphometric method. And so what I wanted to do, if you had a point, and I was saying there was a dominant ear, and I wanted all the dominant ears to be loaded on the left side, so what I would do is if I had a point outline and it had a right side, I would just mirror image the thing and drag the mirror image over here and then finally drag it onto the stack. And that's all 121 wasted Suwannee points. And after doing that, and by the way, the red lines down here are points that had broken ears. So, and the blue lines up here are points that their point was contracting before the top of this measurement area up here because it had been resharpened so much. So I didn't count those, but what I did is the ones that I did count, I would draw a poly line on the inside and a poly line on the outside, and that accounts for 100% of the variation of that particular type that I'm claiming is a type. And having done that with, it's over 600 points, I don't remember the exact count. It was sort of mind-numbing to go through the procedure. I came up with this point typology, and I've been talking for a number of years about Page-Lattson points. Page-Lattson site has now been confirmed by the Center for the Study of First Americans as an honest-to-God pre-Clovis site, 1,500 years before Clovis. That's what we found when we were there with Dave Webb from, 1983 to 1997. And then we came out with the book, and it sort of shook the leaves. There's not supposed to be anything older than pre-Clovis. The Center for the First Americans come in with their dive team, and they not only they found better artifacts, they found a tip of a point. In the same strata, we found these very old bone deposits with flint chips. We'd never found a point in place there. But the type of point we found from displaced context at that site at the time were these things, which I call Page-Lattson points. A lot of them, but not all, are overshot flake. Now, what does that mean? Overshot flaking is a technique that's usually reserved for Clovis-type technology. It's where they're trying to flake the point from one lateral side all the way over to the other lateral side as a means of thinning it by percussion. This is not later periods when they're using pressure flaking to thin the flake. This is a totally Paleo-Indian type of thing. And it shows up on these Page-Lattson points. None of them, not a one of them, are fluted. And where you see that flute-like thing, it's not a flute at all. It's where they took a very thin flake and they bifacially reduced it into a point form, but left part of the original flake scar exposed as a flute-like platform. And I think what happened in Clovis time is they improved on that technique and they started fluting. If we remember at all, anybody that studied Paleo-Indians from the old textbook, there wasn't supposed to be anything older than Clovis. And the oldest points in the Americas, of course, were fluted points. Well, it ain't that way, folks. This is the granddad of Clovis in Florida, at least in my opinion, and with it are these things, Simpson points. People get Simpson and wasted Swanee points mixed up all the time. There is a great difference between them, and I think the greatest difference is the way they were percussion flaking these guys, but they weren't overshot flaking them. If anything, you could say what they were doing is three-quarter shot flakes. They're coming from the laterals, they're going towards the middle, they're going over the middle, and they're coming from the other sides on the giant ones, and it goes over the middle this way. So points like that have a 22-to-1 width to thickness ratio. That's pretty incredible. But that is Clovis-like in a way. But Calvin Jones at the Wakulla Springs Lodge site excavated a Simpson preform, and somebody found this Simpson point at the Wakulla Springs Lodge site. It's now missing in action. It was taken out of there before the state bought the property. And he found Page-Lattson points, apparently on the same level. We went back to that site under a geographic grant, excavated it, and it wasn't the best dating method in the world, but it worked. We used optically stimulated luminescence dating, where you can date the last time a grain of sand saw sunlight, because sunlight erases the clock of the sand in a buried stratigraphic column. And we chose to take the conservative route because of the controversy behind, you know, having something that's older than Clovis. The OSL dates from Wakulla Lodge, The youngest it can possibly be is 13,500. The median date is exactly the same as the Page Latson site at 14,500 or thereabouts. So I think that maybe a wasted knife rather than point and a lancelet, smaller lancelet point, may be the predecessor of Clovis in Florida. And these are two examples, a large Clovis point and a small Clovis point in these big, what I call three-quarter shot flakes. They're big, expanding, wide spatulate flakes that really thin the point very nicely. That point is scarce as hen's teeth, knife, whatever. You don't find very many of them. They're far more uncommon than Clovis. And then there are these things that were found right down here and first recognized in Tampa Bay, Harney Flat site. Nobody was really excited about them, but Randy Daniels called these a lozenge-shaped point. Not a very sexy name either. What's interesting about these, and this doesn't make it so, nobody's found these in a datable context yet, but here are what I would characterize as lozenge-shaped points from Florida. All the ones from Harney Flats are in there, plus a few others. Some come out of river, some don't. And then you've got the Eastern Seaboard Miller or Early Lancelet Point. And these up here are from Meadowcroft Rock Shelter. They date about 16,500 calendar years before present. There's the Cactus Hill Point, and it dates to about 20,000 years before present. And then there are these points down from Miles Point in Maryland. That's Miles Point. Sorry about that. And the dates on that are 24,500. That is before the last glacial maximum. How long were people here? These aren't very... I think many collectors would look at these points and just toss them out. They're not really well made. They occur with a simple sort of micro blade industry almost. They're not real sexy looking. Although Dennis Stanford was one of the first to suggest that these might be Salutrian-like. It's not Iberian, it's Siberian. Sorry about that. And I'll let the people that like to deal with the entry models deal with that. The only thing I'm saying is we don't have these dated yet, but these may be the very oldest form of biface point in Florida. If they match the age of the points that have been found at Meadowcroft in Pennsylvania, at Miles Point in Maryland, and Cactus Hill in Virginia, there's a lot of interesting archaeology that might just show up one day that's a heck of a lot older than we thought it was. Clovis points. This is more or less the classic Clovis point. The excavat type, this is from Silver Springs, and these are from many, many places in Florida, from the Panhandle over in the Chipola River all the way down into Tampa. There's a second type. I'd like to call them wasted Clovis points. If you were up in Ohio, people would call this a Ross County Clovis. But these are a wasted kind of Clovis point. And they're very reminiscent of what I would call a wasted Swanee point. And as a matter of fact, I would say that there's probably a really good likelihood we've never had a Swanee point site dated in Florida or anywhere else. There's no date, there's no temporal context, we don't know. Now, I've got two sites that have Pleistocene fauna associated with them, but we don't know where it fits in time. But Clovis, we do. even from Florida. In fact, the Florida date from Sloth Hole Clovis site is one of the oldest Clovis dates, if you believe in the new revised chronology that Mike Waters at the Center for the First Americans and Tom Stafford, who's a genius in radiocarbon dating, have gone back and redated some of these sites, including Sloth Hole. And Sloth Hole and one other out west, I don't remember that site name, but are right at 13,050 calendar years old, or 11,050 radiocarbon, however you want to look at it. And I think we got a pretty good showing in Florida of Clovis. And, you know, some of these hidden in there, for all I know, may be some transition from one type to another, but I couldn't tell you that. We need the sites, we need to find it in the ground, and we need to be able to date it to know that. And this is, I stepped out of Bullen's typology in this particular case. I'm trying to propose a new point. I want to call it the Harney point, because they found it at Harney Flats. And one of the collectors down here, Brian Evanson, has some really fine examples from the Tampa Bay area. But you find these all over Florida. And these are slight difference, but you know, I'm really into trying to break these things down as to the basal morphology of these things. But this one also has, they start out as a fairly nice lancelet point, but as they get worked down, they tend to have sort of a you know, it's almost like a, what's that point, Eddie, in northeast, anyway, it's this is reminds me of it. It gets sharpened down to sort of straight sides here, and as it gets sharpened down, they start having a problem with stacked hinge fracturing. So you get these buildups on the point, and I guess they can't get it off and they quit using it or something. These are, you know, 59 of them. I would separate these out from Swanee. Now these are the 121 wasted Swanee points, virtually from all over the state. That guy there and I think that guy there are from the Itchituttany that Simpson excavated with the mastodon in 1948, and there are others. And then I don't know what to do. I don't want to go too wild in splitting the points, but there are other forms in the Swanee type collection of Bullen. So I'm just calling these subtypes for right now, and again, until we find these things in stratigraphic context and we can place them in age. But this is just sort of a prominent basal concavity excavate type. This is a minimal basal concavity, and I'd point to these that are not quite flat base, but they're almost flat base. And what's sort of interesting about this point assemblage and a lot of the Florida point assemblages is that overshot flaking is supposed to be a Clovis characteristic. You see that flake right there? That's an overshot flake. It ain't meant to do that, and they were thinning the base in a traditional Swanee style. So, what's going on in Florida? Swanee expanding and flange base. And I look at these and I see different hafting styles. These tend to end up being more triangular, and they're basically sharpening them all the way almost down the whole point, where these guys are sharpening them and stopping. They're not unhafting them, and they end up with this flange base kind of thing. I don't know if this is a different tool made at the same time or different tools, or I'm just seeing things. These two are probably the closest together, and maybe they belong together. I don't know. But it just seems to me, why would you not be unhafting these things, it doesn't seem like, and you end up with this more triangular cross-section, and when you get one resharpened here, you end up with, you know, sort of a different kind of thing going on. Long-eared Swannies. I definitely think these are something different. It may be a different tool type made at the same time that some of the other Swannie forms are being made, or it may be some kind of temporal marker or something like that. But the ears on these things are much longer. They tend to break off a lot easier. And again, we need to find these things in place and get them dated. And then I went out on a limb on this. This is not a type in the traditional sense of the word, but these Simpson-looking things, these Clovis points, these Swannie-like forms, excavate forms, Dalton-like forms, are points that are made that have an extremely... They're made narrow on a narrow cross-section, and they're made very long, almost like a specialty tool, but if this interpretation is correct, they're making them quite a bit through time, I think, on this one. And if you look at the Clovis forms, you can sit there and stack the Clovis forms to the point where it's almost like if this one was that long, you get the, it's almost like a snap blade tool or something like that, if that makes any sense at all. You know, there's metal tools, you can pop the blade off and you got another blade and you can cut with it. It seems like that's some kind of specialty tool, but I don't know exactly what, and maybe one day we can figure it out. Daltons. I always thought there were no Daltons in Florida. Well, a classic Dalton is more common than any other kind of Dalton there is in Florida. They occur pretty much all over the state. There's a big site in the St. John's River and some other places. An uncommon point types one finds in Florida. These are sort of Clovis-like in a way, but they're sort of off-centered blades. They have fluting on some. Others don't have it, but they giant overshot flakes. These are like big Swannie knives or something. They're made on a totally different scale than the other points. And then this one was a surprise to me. Apparently there's two or three of these things in Florida. I have an image of one. That's an agate basin point. That is so far from anything Clovis that you can imagine. It's like a pencil. You know, it's a point like this, and it's flaked down. It's like a spike almost. Closest kind of forms to that, El Hobo in South America, and there are a number of other kind of points that are like that in the Americas. They're really rare in Florida, but the Agate Basin variety, there's about three that I know of. One from Slough Hole, that's from the St. John's River, and there's another one that I need to track the guy down a little bit more. These are interesting. They may be a woodland ceremonial piece, but they have overshot flaking and they are suspiciously similarly looking to some of the Salutrian-like points at Dennis Stanford of the Smithsonian Institute is being found up in Virginia in that area of the world. Apparently they're coming out with a thing on that. Redstones, not common in Florida, it's more up in North Alabama, but you get some. Certain types of Daltons and so forth, and then these oddball things here somehow have become known as mustache Simpsons. I don't care if you call them mustache, but don't call them Simpsons. I don't know what they are, but they're made nothing like a Simpson. These fulsome looking things that are made on thin flakes, I don't know if they're related to something like Page Latson or not, and some that look sort of like it, but they're very nicely bifacially made. They're not very common. Taking all the ones I had from the whole samples and doing this base stacking and then coming out with the maximum outer and the minimum inner profile for the points of the both excavate and fishtailed. You can start playing games like this where you take the Simpson point and compare it to a Clovis wasted, or compare it to a long neck, or you compare it to a Swannie wasted, And in all cases, the Simpsons are just flaring way the hell out and coming back over the, you know, so the Simpson in all cases here is red, but the black silhouette in the background would be the long neck or the Clovis waisted or the Swanee waisted. And I think they're clearly different animals, and the Simpson is just made a completely different way than any of them. And this is the same kind of base matching deal, where you're looking at, say, the page lats and versus the lozenge shape, and you know, the subtle but different variations. Some have higher basal cavities and that type of thing. It will take time and good sites to get a lot of this sorted out. We got to find it in stratigraphic order, and we got to get it dated to really know. Anyway, I'm going to go back to William E. Edwards. He was so far ahead of his time, and he got kicked out of the state of Florida, and I think it's terrible. These three bullet points are what I'd like to bring to your attention. Despite the vast variety of paleopoint shapes in surface collections, excavations at one site had highly specific point types isolated in different components, each of which appeared to have spatial and temporal significance. Where in the hell is that site? He dug that with Clarence Simpson. Differences in the lithic complexes identified in excavations and one in surface collections are great enough to warrant separation of Paleo-Indian artifacts into five different expressions. 1954, he wrote that. He was so far ahead of everybody, it's pathetic. And finally, representing perhaps the earliest occupation, parallel-sided straight base points were found in association with mastodon remains at a site in the Itchituttany River. That would be a different site than the one that Stan Olson looked at. Boy, would I like to know where those points are today. I just don't. And this is, I'm about done. I'm going to make one final observation, and it doesn't really bear on point typology so much as, well, you'll see. This is the state of Florida, Georgia, Alabama, South Carolina, and that map shows where the Floridan Aquifer is not confined in the blue, right? That's the distribution of Paleo-Indian points in Florida. Same distribution pattern. It's not that all lanceolate points are there, but most of them clearly are. And then this is something that Dave Anderson, Chris Gillum, and Mike Fought did on the Paleo-Indian database. You can go out there and find this on the web. This is a distribution of wasted points in the southeast. You don't find them everywhere. You find them strictly in the southeast. Now, try this out. In 2009, some paleontologists testing Dave Webb's original hypothesis back from 1977 that there was something very strange happening in Florida during the Pleistocene. It had more animal species. It had a greater diversity, and it had greater numbers than any other place in North America. And it had species they can't explain to this day that occur up in South Carolina, giant tortoise being a main one, where you expose a giant tortoise to freezing temperatures in the winter and the thing dies of pneumonia, period. But they were roaming up into South Carolina in the Pleistocene. What the heck is all that about? There's a lot that we don't know, but during the Pleistocene, when there was a greater deal of real estate in the state of Florida, you had South and Central American species and you had Western species migrating into what they call the Southeastern Thermal Enclave. And at the end of the Pleistocene, there were more species in the southeast, particularly Florida, that became extinct than any other place in North America, or if they didn't become extinct, they left, like llamas are down in Central and South America, but we don't have them up here anymore. Another form of camel became extinct. Anyway, an assortment of animals, llamas, tapirs, glyptodonts, giant armadillos, jaguars, two kinds of peccaries, capybara, sloths, many different species. And all these animals were here in the Pleistocene and gone at the crack of the Holocene. Something was going on here. It was a very rich fauna zone. And do these wasted points in some way, having the restricted distribution that they do have something to do with some kind of specialized hunting strategy because of the diversity of animals? I don't know, but I can tell you this. It was Florida that had the greatest diversity, and it sort of winnowed out as you went north, and it stopped in about the North Carolina, South Carolina boundary line. And you go too far into North Carolina, and you're up there with the woolly mammoths and a colder kind of thing. So the southeastern U.S., and particularly Florida, I think is going to add a great deal of interesting research in the future. So the end of the Pleistocene and the first Holocene trash. Thanks much. Appreciate it. And anybody's got any questions?
And have anything to do with Vero Beach in Indian River County?
Yeah, it did. Got 1915, I think, was maybe the E.H. Sellards went down there because they were finding fossils in the Vero Canal. And he was all about, you know, getting a good sample of Pleistocene fossils for the Geological Survey and that kind of thing. And he went down there, and then he stumbled on the human artifacts, and all hell broke loose, basically. But along that eastern coast, you run into pockets of fossils. Some of them are late Pleistocene, some of them are much earlier than that. I think there's Bob Carr's site down at Cutler Ridge is one of those. Unfortunately, they only dated the Bolan levels and didn't date below, which is probably Younger Dryas, which is the late end of the Pleistocene. There's a 21,000-year-old fossil site in Palm Beach. You go up to Daytona Beach, Don Serbosic, and a couple other people anyway dug a site, and they found what everybody believes is a Sangamon age. And what I mean by Sangamon age, that would be prior to the late glacial maximum, the last time we had sea level about where it is now, at about 180 or to 100,000 years ago, or somewhere in that ballpark range. They had preserved trees and unfossilized wood in it, but it was way too old to carbon date, so they could never date it, and they didn't have OSL dating. There were no artifacts there. But I'm just saying, all up and down the East Coast, there are fossil pockets, some of this age, some of that age, and some of them have produced artifacts like Vero. And whether those artifacts are associated or not, there was such a firestorm, a controversy between 1915 and 1918. Nobody really knows, so they're going to test it and hopefully be able to definitively answer that. Well, I think it's pretty clear. You got to have the sediment, and you got to...
What was the question?
There's a difference between channel fill and channel cut sediments. And even the Santa Fe is a good oddball question. If you're up in South Carolina, and what's the river the topper site's on?
Savannah.
Savannah River, anyway. Now that river in the Pleistocene was much larger. The water was coming out of the mountains, and it was ripping down, and during a certain part of the Pleistocene, it had a braided channel system, which is, geologically speaking, very high energy, capable of taking giant boulders and moving that down and slushing it out. With the exception of the Apalachicola River, which has its headwaters up in the Georgia Mountains, and even the Apalachicola isn't a good example of this because it rolls over limestone terrain and it goes under and up a little bit in the channel itself, but most of the channels in Florida, and the Santa Fe is the one that's got me puzzled the most. There's a geologic term called anastomosing. Yeah, I know. Don't ask me how to spell that right now. But all it means is it looks sort of like a braided channel, but it's made in a very different way. It's very, very low energy. And I've been taking LIDAR and doing bare ground models of the Santa Fe River, and it had a channel in the Pleistocene that looks ditto like the Wasissa does today. You can go paddling down the Wasissa and it's this big wide thing, and all of a sudden it goes into the swamp and it's 1,000 channels going back through there. But it's a very low flowing kind of river, and the channels tend to channel fill rather than channel cut. And so you're in the Wasissa River today and a tree slams over the channel like that, and it blocks enough blocking vegetation, and all of a sudden it's not flowing down that channel too well. What the heck, we'll go over on this channel and flow down that one for a while. It's not that you don't get channel cut, you do a little bit, but when at Page Latson site you got a 7-meter column of sediment, that you're not going to find that up in the Savannah River. Well, you might, but it would be of some giant flooding event where you can tell when the river was flowing, you can tell when the river wasn't flowing. In some cases, there's strong evidence that the bottom of the river, now 30 feet below sea level, was actually exposed as a dry land surface, and certain kinds of sediments were oxidizing away. So there are those kinds, and there are a lot of types, and I sort of got away from the point I was trying to make about the Santa Fe River. It's an anastomosing channel in the Pleistocene, right? It's just going all over the place. There's multiple channels. I don't know how it got from that to a single unified channel that it is today in the Holocene, because it's counterintuitive. You'd think the Pleistocene water tables would be lower. Well, they were sometimes, but it turns out Tom Scott, who's a retired assistant state geologist, turned me on to this. He was saying just because Florida had a sea level 200 feet below its present level or something like that in the Pleistocene doesn't mean that all the channel systems in the limestone terrain are going to go dry. If you got a lot of rain all the time, they're going to flow. If you get drought conditions over an extended period, they're going to draw down or go dry. And the trick is now is to find out in those areas where you have that kind of preserved sediment, that type of answer, and what's going on there. And I think at 18,500 in the Santa Fe River bottom, at that site, named after Don Monroe, the riverbed was just dry, and there were trees growing there, and somehow some of the stumps survived, and we could carbon date it. At another place downstream from there, where there was a Deptford age fish weir found in the middle of the river, a river diver reported that, limestone crevice out into the middle of the river, flat limestone bottom elsewhere, and here are these stakes. You know, about, I think it was about a baker's dozen, maybe 14 stakes, jammed into this thing. One was pulled out, it was carved on the end, sent it into carbon date, it's Deptford age. So there are different kinds of things, you know, preserved in the river channel. It's just recognition of it. And I'm not going to deny you can't find pop tops and paleo points in the same stratigraphic level. But I can tell you this, it's highly disappointing to me. I recorded a site in 1980 off the mouth of Blue Springs Run in the upper Withlacoochee River. And at that time, I found a cemented sandstone deposit about that thick, full of artifacts. Recorded it and left. Found a base of a paleopoint in it. I was pretty excited about that. And I got out of the underwater program, and my office before I retired was doing land archaeology, and I teamed up with this other guy. We go out. So we checked Blue Springs in 2007 or something like that, whatever year we were there. And that entire deposit was gone. And the park ground, oh yeah, the guys came in with their scooters and just blew it out. Now, it may be a sandstone deposit that isn't that significant, but unless you go down there and test it and give it a chance, what do you, I mean, it's just nuts. It's just too much. And I'm not trying to lecture you, I just, it is such a frustrating thing for me because I've worked with collectors and none of the people in this room that I know of do that kind of thing. But there's a small minority out there and the amount of money they're making is just a sin. They're selling our heritage just to the highest bidder, whether they're from Japan, France, or the U.S. I don't know what to say. Anything else? Well, thanks.
Thank you. Okay, everybody, thanks for coming in.